right. Ready for some push-ups now? Well, good morning. My name is Glenn Griner. I'm one of the associate pastors here, and it's an honor for me to bring God's Word to you today. I'm really excited about what I believe He wants to impart in you and share with you. And before we do that, I want to start off with prayer. Would you bow your heads with me? Hey, Jesus, we come humbly into your presence. Lord, we declare that we are nothing without you. And so, God, we need your help. So, God, wipe away the weights, the cares, concerns of our week and our lives, and help us to connect with you. Jesus, thank you for meeting every single person here. Thank you for touching each one of them. And so, God, I pray that you would speak in spite of me, that your word, that nothing would come between the word you have for every person here and the things that they need to receive. And so bless us, God, with your presence, with your love, and your grace. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Well, I'm kicking off a three-week series called Stronger. And obviously, you got it from the video, that we're not necessarily focusing upon the things that our world calls strong. We're focusing upon those things that God calls strong, a strength from a different perspective. And the title to today's message is Don't Give Up. And it's not about doing push-ups. It's not about lifting weights. It's not about driving fast. It's about trusting God. Now, I want to give you a heads up. The passage of Scripture that we're going to kind of dig into today is one of the more challenging passages of Scripture because Jesus says some things that can be easily misunderstood. You've probably never heard a message on this passage before and may never hear one on this passage again either. But I want you to really take encouragement from these things, even though they might be a little bit confusing. So if you would, turn in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 15. We're going to begin reading in verse 21. If you don't mind, stand in honor of reading God's Word. The reason we stand as we read the Bible is because it's the promises of God. It's the primary way that God speaks to us. So if you would, of course, the words will appear on the screen as well. Matthew 15, verse 21. Leaving that place, meaning Jerusalem and Judea, Jesus withdrew to the region of Tyre and Sidon. And a Canaanite woman from that vicinity came to him crying out, Lord, son of David, have mercy on me. My daughter is demon-possessed and suffering terribly. Jesus did not answer a word. He didn't say anything. It felt really awkward, even more awkward than it feels right now. Jesus didn't answer her a word. So his disciples came to him and urged him, send her away, for she keeps crying out after us. Jesus answered, I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. The woman came and knelt before him. Lord, help me, she said. And he replied, it is not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs. Yes, it is, Lord, she said. Even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table. Then Jesus said to her, Woman, you have great faith. Your request is granted. And her daughter was healed at that moment. You may be seated. I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, what have I gotten myself into this morning? But let me encourage you. Jesus, he was not dogging this woman. He was not on her case. He was dogging the disciples, as we'll see here in a minute. But she did. She got the silent treatment, didn't she? Now, we all know what it's like to get the silent treatment, especially the men in the room. The men in the room know what it's like to receive the silent treatment. We're very familiar with that. If you've been in a relationship with a woman, you have probably received the silent treatment at some point or another. Now, ladies, I have a confession to make. The silent treatment never works. You're thinking, oh, yes, it does. But it's not really the silent treatment that works. You see, here's just a little bit of free information for you. Did you know that 85% of communication is nonverbal? And so it's only 15% what you say or what you don't say. And so here's what happens. Your man comes home or greets you after work or whatever, and it's quiet. And he's loving it because men like silence. They love quiet. They're having a nice, relaxing hour just sitting there with you. And then finally, we decide to break the silence and say, honey, how was your day? And then you want to tell us exactly how your day was. You really want to tell us, but you've invoked the dreaded silent treatment, so you can't break the silent treatment. And then what you do is you look at us with a look that looks like this picture coming up on the screens. And we know the next thing that's going to happen to us is this. All kidding aside, silent treatment does hurt, especially when it has to do with perceived rejection. If you've been around long enough, if you've maybe asked someone out on a date or let someone know that you liked them, and then all of a sudden you didn't hear anything back, it kind of hurts, doesn't it? That's not very fun. That's not like my top 10 things I like to have happen to me. You know, but the most difficult silent treatment happens when you have a lot of hope in the relationship. Maybe you went out with someone for an extended period of time, and you're thinking, you know, this relationship has some potential. I think this right may really go somewhere, and I'm excited about this. And then all of a sudden, to you, out of the blue, they disappear off the planet Earth. They don't respond to your calls or emails. The place they usually go, they're not there. You might see them across the room, and then all of a sudden, they turn their head and disappear. And that's painful. That hurts because you have a lot of hope in that relationship. And so sometimes when we get the silent treatment from Jesus, we think he's mad at us, or he's frustrated with us, or he doesn't love us or like us. And that's not at all the case, because when you get the silent treatment from Jesus, his motives are completely different. And this woman got the silent treatment from Jesus, didn't she? This leads up to my first point, point one. It says, don't give up when Jesus seems silent. Now think of all the hope this woman had in Jesus. Her daughter was severely demon-possessed. There's no doctor that can help her. Jesus is her only hope. And she comes into his presence and she says, "Oh Lord, Son of David, help." And then silence. You can feel the confusion and maybe even the pain and the worry in her heart here. Now, unlike the schmuck who wouldn't return your phone calls or who ran away when he or she saw you coming, Jesus, he has your best interest in heart. You see, God's silence, it's never cruel. And God always uses those silent times to develop us, to grow us, and make us stronger. And there's a lot happening in this passage that is very easy to overlook. And the first thing you have to do is consider everybody here at the party. So there's Jesus. Obviously, there's this woman and the disciples. Now, if you read this passage thinking that the disciples, they're just bystanders, they're just kind of watching things happen, you'll miss the whole point, because the primary lesson was to them. But Jesus was also speaking to this woman. You see, this woman didn't realize this, but the silence she was experiencing wasn't all about her. It wasn't all about her. It was also about the disciples. But even though the silence wasn't all about her, God was doing something special in her life through this silence. You see, in this silence, God was reaching out and drawing out her faith. Because in that resistance that he provided, she found greater courage. You see, when God is silent and you keep seeking him, your trust grows. You know, when you're flying blind with God, it literally builds our faith. Just look at this woman. Yes, Jesus, he didn't say anything to her, but she knew just by his nonverbal communication that he was for her, that he was with her, that he didn't want her just to run away. In fact, this silence helped build her resolve. And waiting builds our character. It does. And that's what God is using in those quiet times. Now, just raise your hand if you like to wait, and I don't like to wait. No one likes waiting. No one likes waiting. I mean, it goes against our patience. It goes against, you know, our self-centeredness, you know, which I am. Who likes waiting? In fact, I try to make a point never to say the P word from the pulpit. Patience. Because I'm happy with, if God's happy with what the patience I have, then I'm happy with it too. I never pray for more patience because I know that God is going to give me a chance to exercise that patience. And so when God is quiet, we need to trust him and look to him even more than when things are going great or we're really hearing from him. Elmer Towns, he's just a saint of God. He's written so many books on prayer and fasting, and an amazing communicator, amazing preacher. I'd like to put this quote up on the screen. I think it will help us gain unique perspective here. It says these words, "Just as there is a sun on the other side of the clouds being the challenges and the silence of God, so God is speaking beyond his silence. We need to learn to listen through the sounds of silence and tune in to the voice of God that rings out loudly in the world he created, the word he composed, and the word incarnate." You see, to us, to you and to me, when we're getting the silent treatment from Jesus, it seems like nothing's happening. Have you ever had that feeling, my prayers aren't getting past the ceiling? If you've had that thought, or if you've made that statement before, you know what it's like to kind of have the silent treatment. But rest assured, God is not ignoring you. He's not overlooking you. He hasn't forgotten about you. He is hard at work in you. He's not working against you. He's working in you. Because every bit of silence that you work through, he turns that into trust and builds your faith. Some of the most meaningful growth in your relationship with Jesus happens when you can't seem to hear his voice. Because that's when you take those steps of courage and faith. So let me encourage you, even when Jesus seems quiet, keep asking, keep trusting, because his answer is always worth waiting for. Our second point that we get from this interaction that Jesus had with his disciples and this woman is this: don't give up when what's happening doesn't make sense. Now, if you've been alive on the earth, if you've talked to other people, you know that there are circumstances that just defy explanation, aren't there? I mean, life is not fair. It is not fair. And it seems like for some people, bad things just keep happening to them over and over. And not necessarily due to their choices either. And when things seem unfair, it's easy, or we don't understand what's going on, it's easy for us to get frustrated with God and maybe even turn our back on him. But what we fail to realize when we want to do that is that there's more going on than we can ever comprehend. You see, God, he has this amazing perspective that we don't have. He sees your life and my life in light of eternity. He knows everything that's happening to us. He knows what our future holds. And he's with us every step of the way. And he knows how we're going to grow through these challenging times. And there's no way this woman could have known that Jesus was using this silence to draw out her faith and build her faith. And there's no possible way that she could have known that Jesus was trying to teach his own disciples an important lesson. Well, let's talk about the disciples a little bit and kind of get a feel for where they're at. Remember, this is one of the most important lessons that they will learn, that salvation is for everyone, not just the Jews. And so all the disciples were Jews. They grew up in Jewish culture. They worshiped in the synagogue. They worshiped right along with the Pharisees and the other religious leaders. And Jesus had been getting on their case a little bit about challenging them to let go of some of these traditions that weren't necessarily lining up with his concept of God. And so they were stuck on the rules that these Jewish leaders had made more than the rules that God had made through his word. So they were stuck in all the details and all the minutiae of the rules. And so one of those things that the disciples held on to, which is a very common Jewish belief, was a disrespect or even dislike for people who weren't Jewish. And this can be traced back throughout their history. You know, if you've read the Old Testament, you know that there were times when the Jewish people fell away from God. There are times when they turned their back on God and started worshiping other gods. And so, as a whole, the Jewish culture thought, well, it's those Canaanite people who had those other gods. It's their fault that we worship their God. So they kind of passed the blame there. And so that's where a lot of this came from. But right before Jesus' encounter with this Canaanite woman, he had been speaking to the disciples, and he said words like this. He said, "Something from the outside can't make you a sinner. It's not what you eat. It's not what you touch. It's not where you walk that causes sin. It's what comes out of your mouth. It's the words that you say, the things that you do, because what comes out of you is what comes out of your heart. And so if your heart is bad, then that's what needs to be fixed, not things on the outside." And Peter, he was confused. You got to love Peter. He said, Jesus, explain this to us. And Jesus says, are you still so dull? Are you still so dull? And the Greek word for dull can be translated doofuses. Just kidding. It really can't be translated that. But that kind of gets the point across. He's frustrated with them. And so both in Matthew and in Mark, it goes straight from this account with Jesus getting on the disciples' case about the rules, about their thought about Gentiles. It goes right to them being in this Gentile territory with this woman. And you see, if Jesus doesn't break this type of thinking, Christianity is not going to grow. It's not going to spread past the Jewish faith. Because salvation is for everyone. If salvation is for everyone, then salvation is also for you and for me. I want you to think about this. Think about how Jesus wanted the disciples to feel about this woman. Or maybe ask this question. How do you think Jesus felt about this woman and her daughter who was suffering? Think about the compassion of Jesus. Think about his love and his care. Think about his amazing concern for people. Don't you know that he was deeply moved by this woman's request? I'm convinced that from the beginning, Jesus wanted the disciples to do the right thing. He wanted his disciples to pray for this woman's daughter to be healed, for this demon to be cast out of her. That's why he was quiet for so long. And yet they didn't. They weren't getting the lesson. They weren't moving on. They weren't understanding what Jesus wanted to do. And so in the midst of all this, the disciples, they made the wrong response. They actually begged Jesus to send this woman away. They're saying, Jesus, please do us a favor. Get rid of this woman. They're kind of like whining like kids, like little kids. No, please get her out of here. She's bothering us. Get us out of her. And so what they're saying is that this sound of this woman crying out for help was irritating. They couldn't see past their own measly level of comfort and see the needs of this precious person. My friends, that's the ugly demonic force of racism. Now, just a hunch, I bet Jesus was really frustrated at this point. He really wanted his disciples to get it, and yet they weren't getting it. Which leads to these next comments that Jesus makes, and the things that kind of set you on edge as we're reading the passage earlier when I started today. And the first thing he said that was kind of hard to hear was that I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Now, just to give you a little bit of background before you panic, because most of us in this room are not Jews, you know, Romans 10:12 does say this. It does say, for there is no difference between Jew or Gentile. The same Lord is the Lord of all and richly blesses all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Now, that's great news. Jesus said it himself in John 3:16, for God loved the world so much that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. And then perhaps the most important words Jesus said were the last words he said before he ascended up into heaven after his resurrection. He said these words. He said, all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. And he said, therefore, go and make disciples of all nations. And this word nations means ethnos. It means every tribe, every tongue, every single person on the face of the earth. We need to baptize them in the name of the Father and Son and Holy Spirit and teach them to obey everything that he's commanded. Okay, a little bit of background there. So, true or false, Jesus was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. False, you're correct. Now, true or false, Jesus said, I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. True. Houston, we have a problem. Now, either this is the one secret sin of Jesus, or there's something else happening here. Either Jesus really doesn't care about this woman, or he's trying to communicate something else. What Jesus was doing was he was letting the disciples' incorrect thinking, he was kind of begging the question a little bit. He was drawing that. He was going along with them in order to teach them a hard lesson. And so these disciples, they're way out of their own comfort zone. You see, for a Jew, they had all these rules they had to follow. You know, if they touched a Gentile, they had to do this washing. All the food they ate had to be prepared a certain way. They weren't allowed to go into Jewish territory. I mean, all these. And so here they are. They're doing all these things. They're in a Jewish territory. They're staying in a non-Jewish territory. They're in a Gentile's house, eating food that a Gentile has prepared. And so they're way, way, way out of their comfort zone. And Jesus is liking that because he wants them to realize the truth of his love for every single person in the world. And then Jesus makes this next statement, which gets everyone's attention. He says this: it's not right to take the children's bread and throw it to the dogs or the little dogs. I wish I could have seen the disciples' faces when Jesus dropped that bomb on them. I really wish, because their eyes probably got this big around. They're like, did he just say that? Because you see, the Jews, they often referred to Gentiles as dogs. And this was a very offensive word. Now, Jesus did not use the word dogs, just so you know. I mean, that's a different word. The word that Jesus uses, the word for little puppy, which is called kunarion, that's the Greek word. Just so you know that Jesus wasn't like, you know, truly slamming someone. I do want you to know that. But indulge me in some scriptural speculation. This passage doesn't really say what the disciples were thinking. But I would imagine they were sick of this woman. They wanted her gone, obviously. They didn't care about her needs. They didn't care about her plight. And so Jesus said the words that they were thinking that they weren't willing to say. And obviously this response was meant more for the disciples than this precious woman. Jesus shocked the disciples by bringing their racism and sin right out in the open. It's like that old-fashioned way of getting siblings to stop fighting. Maybe you know, you had a sister or a brother and maybe you guys were going at it. Maybe you're at grandpa's house with grandpa and grandma, and you're fighting, and grandpa's fed up. He says, oh, get over here. You guys stop fighting. Well, he did it, she did it. You know how that goes. And then grandpa says, okay, you want to fight? Okay, hit your brother. Hit him hard. You're going to take turns. Need to hurt him good. Come on. Rear back, big swing. Come on. No, grandpa, I can't hit my brother. Okay, well, hit your sister. Come on. Make a big fist. Give her a good one. He goes, no, grandpa, I can't hit my sister. I can't do that. We can't fight. Well, good, then stop fighting. And then it's over for at least 15 minutes. You see, what Jesus is doing is he's throwing it right in their face. He's throwing their sin right in their face by playing along with them. That's the lesson to the disciples. But the lesson to this woman is very important. And do not miss this. Don't ever forget that God is for you, that God is with you, that he is on your side. No matter how confusing things are, Jesus is for you. When your life seems to be unraveling at the seams and you don't know what to do, Jesus is with you. When you cry out to God and you hear nothing, God is for you. I'd like for you to look at this passage of scripture up on the screen. It comes from Romans 8:31. And it says these words: what then shall we say in response to these things? And these things are the challenges of life, the hard things in life. If God is for us, then what? Who can be against us? Who can be against us? I love how this woman addressed Jesus when she first shows up. She says, Lord, Son of David. And Son of David is an amazing messianic reference. She's basically saying, I know you're the Messiah. I know you're the Son of God. What an awesome, awesome claim. This woman who's not a Jew makes this such an impressive statement, saying that he's the Son of God. You see, she knew who she was talking to. When you're praying and you're confused, don't forget that God is with you, that he's on your side. Who could be more for you than Jesus Christ? And how can you know that Jesus is for you? He's not just the Messiah. He's your Messiah. He died on the cross to pay for your sins. He was resurrected to offer you a life that is more than you could ever imagine, both in the here and now and in eternity in heaven. Jesus is for you because he is your creator, and he gave up everything so that you could know him. And so he's with you. He's on your side. Now, just to be honest, if I could see my guardian angel, if I knew I had a guardian angel and he was like behind me all the time, I'd feel pretty good. Now, what if the archangel Gabriel himself, like the big dude with the flaming sword, what if he was always by my side? I'd feel really good. But those two guys, as amazing as they are, they pale in comparison to the Son of God. The one and only Son of God. not only does he have your back, he's in you. He's on you. He's in your mind. He's in your heart. And he wants the best for you. And you can trust him. No matter what is going on, you can trust him. So don't give up when you can't make sense of what God is doing. My third point is this. When you want to give up, and at times you will, if you live long enough, there'll be times that you want to give up, reaffirm your trust in Jesus. You know, we're all impressed by this woman and her faith, but also this clever response that she gave Jesus. And Jesus, he was impressed by her response too. But what really moved Jesus was this woman's trust. She tried begging, she tried pleading, she even pushed through the rejection that I'm sure the disciples sent her way, through dirty looks and even asking Jesus to make this woman leave. She pushed through all those things, and then she got stuck in the middle of this lesson that Jesus is trying to teach the disciples. And she just knelt at the feet of Jesus. And this word knelt, it's more than a physical position. It's more than just being on your knees. In fact, the King James Version of the Bible translates this as worshiped. It conveys respect and honor and love. So the point is this. Look at these words up on the screen. God isn't moved by clever remarks. He is moved by worship. He is moved by prayer. He is moved by surrender. He is moved by trust. She pushed through all these challenging obstacles, and her response to all these things, right after Jesus said, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel," she said these words, "No, Lord, the puppies eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." And I don't think she was trying to trick Jesus or manipulate Jesus or impress Jesus. I think that's the response you make when you trust someone. You see, she trusted Jesus. She knew that just the crumbs from the Son of God were enough to take care of her daughter. She knew that he had more than enough to meet her need. She knew that she could trust him no matter what was going on. What amazing faith. What amazing love. I want that in my life, and I know you do too. You see, she knew that the God she grew up with, Baal, he couldn't help her daughter. No one in the temple of Aphrodite could address her daughter's need, only Jesus. And as she worshiped Jesus, she turned her back on the God she grew up with. She knew better than anybody else, they were powerless. She had no other hope but Jesus. And so despite the silence, despite the confusion, she praised Jesus as she bowed down. And then she prayed the most important prayer of all, I think. Lord, help. Lord, help me. She said these words, Lord, she recognized who Jesus was. Help. She laid her heart out before him. There is incredible power and prayer and worship. You see, prayer, it cuts down doubt. Worship wipes away unmet expectations. And prayer sets your mind and your heart on Jesus. And worship is especially powerful in times of crisis. And don't you know, the hardest time to worship is when you feel far from God. The hardest time to pray is when you feel like your prayers aren't getting anywhere. But that's also the most important time to pray. That's the most important time to worship. And sometimes it just helps us to raise our hands. I love this picture of raising our hands in worship. Because whenever I'm standing before God and I lift up my hands, I can't help but lift up my head. See, no more is my face down on my problems. No longer am I fumbling with these issues in front of me. I've let go of them. And I've turned my eyes to heaven. I've turned my face towards God. And I'm focusing upon Him. I'm obsessing on God and not my problems. And that, my friends, makes a difference. When you do that, you won't give up. You see, worship allowed her to see something bigger than her circumstances, something bigger than she could understand. So focus upon who God is. Focus on what He has done and how He has been faithful. Because get this, the character of God is always bigger than your pain. You see, God, He's still good, even if your world is turned upside down. God is still on the throne, even if your life feels like it's in chaos. And God is still faithful, even if He hasn't met your expectations. So worship Him for who He is, and watch your faith grow. Watch God do amazing things in your heart and in your life. I'm so inspired by King David. He knew what it was like to be down in the dumps. He knew what it was like to feel far from God and wonder what in the world was going on. in this verse as it comes up on the screen in Psalm 42:11, he's saying these words. He's coaching himself. He's saying, "Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why are you so down? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God." He's coaching himself. "Put your hope in God, David, for I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God." This next one is Psalm 73:26. It says, "My heart and my flesh may fail." He's out of gas. "But God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever." God is enough. Even in your weakness, God is your strength. Do you remember those old movies, those black and white movies, and someone would get hysterical about something and they couldn't calm down, and then someone would come by and slap them, smack some sense into them? Just for your information, I do not recommend that whatsoever in any relationship or any circumstance, but it's really funny. You see, that's what worship does for me. It smacks some sense into me because I can get all hysterical. "Oh no, this problem, what's going on? What's this problem? I can't deal with it." But then when I turn my face to heaven, it's not like God slaps me, but worship slaps all that fear down, all that worry. When I start looking at God, it just smacks it away. See, prayer will slap the doubt out of you. You see, when you worship, when you pray, God shows up. You see, he sets your heart right. He speaks truth to push away that fear. He speaks love to wipe away that doubt. And when you worship, your God gets bigger and your crisis gets smaller every single time. So if you can't hear God, worship him. If you're confused by how he's responding, pray to him. If your life is in turmoil and you don't know what the future holds, trust him. Without worship, without prayer, without trust, you will completely misinterpret what God wants to do in you. You will think he does not care, when that's the very opposite, because God loves you very much. He cares very deeply about you. Perhaps you know someone who's been through some really challenging things. They had a relationship with God, and maybe they prayed for a loved one to be healed, and that didn't happen. Maybe they were trusting God to come through and provide for their needs in a specific way, and that didn't happen. And then they turned their back on God and said, "There is no God. If he can't take care of this, he's not worth serving." And they turn their back on God and walk away. What they did not do is they did not reach out to God in the midst of that. You see, pain has a polarizing effect on you and me. Just like families that go through extreme grief, that grief can draw families together, that challenge can draw families together, it can also blow families up. And the same thing is true in your relationship with Jesus. When you walk through a tough time, you might just say, "God, I'm sick of this. I'm leaving." Or you might say, "God, I need you all the more." When you respond with, "God, I need you. Lord, help me," he is there for you. He is there with you. You can trust him. Let him meet you right where you are. And he will bless you, encourage you, and help you through perhaps the most challenging season of your life. Because without worship, without this connection, you'll misinterpret what God's doing in your life. And so, when you feel blind, when you feel hopeless, reaffirm your trust in God. Now, maybe everything's going great in your life. Maybe you're doing wonderful. We've just come off serve week. You might still be riding on a high from that, and that's awesome. But maybe you've come in here this morning, and you feel like this Canaanite woman. Your choice is to focus on your problems and be overwhelmed, or focus on Jesus and find his help and his strength. Consider all the amazing things that Jesus did in this woman's heart through her interaction with him. I know there are people in this room right now who are struggling. There's so many financial challenges in our culture today. Many of you have lost your jobs. Maybe some of you have lost a job and finally found a job, but that job really isn't enough to make ends meet. And that is stressful. That is hard. It's challenging. So many people are struggling in their marriages. I mean, they're really trying to make things work, but things just seem to short circuit. It's hard. And some people, there's lots of conflict in homes between parents and children. There's so many challenges to deal with. so many hard things. Let me let you know, God is with you. He has your back. Maybe there's things you've heard from God that have confused you. Maybe you're wondering and questioning. It's okay to bring those questions to God. Tell him how you feel. Tell him how angry you might be. It's okay. God's not going to run away in fear. And then after you're done telling him how you feel, say, God, I trust you. I don't understand, but I trust you. And I'm not going to leave. I'm going to keep seeking you with all of my heart. And you will find the greatest gift of all. You will find a strength that the problems of life can't touch. You'll find love and faith that's bigger than any problem the devil can throw at you. That's what it means to have the strength of God in your life, the power of God. So let me encourage you, cry out to God. Don't give up. Trust him. Let him answer your prayers in his way. And sometimes the best prayer you can pray is this woman's prayer. Lord, help me. Lord, help me. In fact, it'll probably help us just to say that out loud together. When I say these words, we pray, all of us will say, Lord, help me. We pray, Lord, help me. Let's say that again. We pray, Lord, help me. Would you stand with me and we'll close in prayer this morning? And I'm going to say a few things and we're going to say that phrase again. I'm going to say we pray and then I'd appreciate it if you'd follow that with Lord, help me. And really make this your prayer this morning. Would you bow your heads with me? Jesus, some of us, we've come in today and we're facing incredibly challenging circumstances and we need wisdom and direction. And so we pray, Lord, help me. Some of us are here today because we can't make sense of everything going on in our lives. We pray, Lord, help me. Maybe you're at your wit's end and your only hope is Jesus. We pray, Lord, help me. Someone came in today shaking their fist at God, and now you are choosing to worship him instead. We pray, Lord, help me. Lord, as I close this prayer with my friends, I thank you that just like this woman's daughter was miraculously healed, we ask right now that you would do miracles in our midst, that you would heal diseases and sickness all over our church and all through our families. Lord, we pray for cancer to disappear. We pray for pain in our bodies to go away. We ask that autoimmune disorders and nervous disorders would, like Doc 8, would be wiped away. We pray for supernatural healing. Come, power of God. We stand against depression in Jesus' name. Lord, we rip the thought of suicide out of people's minds right now, and we say hope is coming right now for you. We speak healing to broken marriages. We speak peace between parents and children. And Jesus, all over this room, we reaffirm our trust in you. We tell you that you are the Lord of all, that you are worthy of praise. Even in our challenges, even in our pain, and even in our doubt, we praise you, we worship you, we love you, and we bless you. We place our lives in your hands. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.